Welcome to the short tutorial from Pathology Made Simple at ilopathology.com. Today's topic is intracellular accumulations. To be more specific, we'll be discussing about accumulation of lipids. Now, the learning objectives for today's topic is, I'll just give you a brief overview of what intracellular accumulations means, and we'll talk more about intracellular accumulation of lipids. In that, we'll discuss more about accumulation of neutral fat, that is a triester of fatty acids and glycerol, which means we'll be discussing more about the fatty change. Second, we'll talk about accumulation of cholesterol and cholesterol esters. Now, what is this intracellular accumulation? See, it is basically a manifestation of metabolic derangement, which means substances, can accumulate in abnormal amounts in the cell. Within the cell, it can accumulate in the cytoplasm, it can accumulate in the organelles, or it can accumulate in the nucleus. So it's basically building up of products of metabolism within the cell. Okay, now accumulation can be transient and reversible, or it can be permanent. See, the effects depends upon the amount of accumulated substances within the cell. If the accumulated substance is of milder degree, then the effects are reversible. If it is of severe degree, then the effect can be very toxic to that particular cell, and that's because of irreversible cell damage. Now let us understand why these cells gets accumulated of abnormal substances. The basic reasons could be, one, it could be accumulations of normal constituents of cell metabolism. That means that's because maybe due to the defects in packaging or transport. So we will discuss more about accumulation of fats, accumulation of proteins, and accumulation of carbohydrates. The second scenario could be accumulations of metabolites due to some enzyme deficiencies. Here we will discuss about storage diseases and inborn errors of metabolism. The third one is accumulation of pigments. See, these pigments are accumulated because there is no mechanism, there is no enzymatic mechanism to degrade these pigments, which could be endogenous pigments or exogenous pigments. And lastly, there could be accumulation of abnormal substances, which can be resulting due to acquired or genetic defects. And the most common example which we discuss over here is alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency. Now, this is a normal cell with its normal nucleus and organelles. When there is an altered or abnormal metabolism occurring in this particular cell, it could result in accumulation of substances. Okay, in this particular case, there is accumulation of fat in the cell, and that is fat liver, which is what we'll be discussing in the next few minutes. Now, what is fatty change? Fatty change is also referred to as steatosis or fatty metamorphosis. It's basically intracellular accumulation of neutral fat. Neutral fat means triglycerides within the parenchymal cells. It is more common in liver because you know that liver is the most common site of metabolism. It is also common in other organs like heart, skeletal muscle, and kidneys. So what are the causes of fatty liver? The most common cause of fatty liver is alcohol abuse. The other causes being diabetes, obesity, protein energy malnutrition, certain drugs and toxins. It could be anoxia or hypoxia, or it can be seen in pregnancy. Okay, so to understand more about the etiopathogenesis, let us know what happens in the normal metabolism of. See, the free fatty acids, either it could be from the diet or from the adipose tissue, it enters the liver. Okay, the fatty acid not only is from the diet or adipose tissue, the fatty acid is also synthesized by the acetyl-CoA. These fatty acids, with the action of alpha-glycerophosphate, they are esterified to form triglycerides. Okay, small amounts of fatty acids are converted to cholesterol, they're converted to phospholipids, and they are oxidized to ketone bodies. Okay, now these triglycerides, again with the help of apoprotein, they're converted to lipoprotein, which is then excreted out of the liver. So what is more important here is that this understanding of the steps of fat metabolism is more important to understand the etiopathogenesis. The first one is entry of fatty acids. The second one is synthesis of fatty acids by acetyl-CoA. The third one is esterification of fatty acids. Four, oxidation of fatty acids to ketone bodies. Then with the help of apoprotein, formation of lipoproteins. And subsequently, release of lipoprotein outside the liver. Okay, now let us see how these mechanisms, when they are deranged, results in fatty liver. The first one is, so whenever there is excess entry of lipids into the liver, obviously you mean to say that there is increase in the amount of free fatty acids, and this particular entity can be due to either obesity or diabetes or alcohol consumption or increased consumption of fat rich foods. Okay, the second step is enhanced fatty acid synthesis by the hepatocytes. So this is more common in diabetes mellitus. So we all know that in diabetes mellitus there is increased levels of glucose and process of glycolysis. Glucose is converted to pyruvate and then pyruvate is converted to acetyl-CoA. Okay, so that means to say that whenever there is increased amount of glucose, there is increased amount of acetyl-CoA formation. And when you have more and more acetyl-CoA, then there is increased synthesis of fatty acids as well. The fourth one is, whenever there is increased esterification of fatty acids to triglycerides, then you obviously you can expect that the amount of triglycerides within the liver will be increased. So alcohol again here is the most common cause. Fifth one, decreased oxidation of fatty acids by mitochondria. The causes being hypoxia, alcohol, and certain liver toxins can cause decreased oxidation. So whenever there is decreased oxidation, obviously it means to say that the fatty acids are converted more into triglycerides and then the triglycerides accumulate. So in cases of protein energy malnutrition, so there is decreased apoprotein synthesis. Okay, that in malnutrition and carbon tetrachloride poisoning, triglycerides are not converted to lipoprotein, which means to say that there is accumulation of triglycerides. The last one is, there can be impaired lipoprotein excretion. So this again is the result of alcohol consumption. So with this flowchart, it's easy to understand that any one of these mechanisms can be operating in the cause of fat liver. But in the case of alcoholic liver disease or in case of alcohol consumption, it is multifactorial. As you can see here, that alcohol can cause increased esterification of fatty acids, alcohol can cause impaired excretion, alcohol can cause decreased oxidation of fatty acids by mitochondria. So alcohol can also result in excessive entry of lipids into the liver. So alcohol induced fatty liver is multifactorial. That is what is more important in understanding the fatty change due to alcohol consumption. How does fatty liver looks grossly? So you know that grossly fat looks yellowish, isn't it? So while explaining the changes of fatty liver on gross examination, we need to concentrate on these things. One, size; two, capsule; three, margins; and four, color. Now size, obviously the size of the liver is increased, the capsule is tensed and it is stretched, the margins, which normally is sharp, now becomes rounded and smooth. On cut surface, the liver slightly bulges, okay, and the color could be pale yellow to yellowish. Now, what is a microscopic feature of fatty liver? You know that grossly the fat looks yellowish, whereas microscopically during the processing stages, you know, the fat gets dissolved. So obviously it looks clear in microscopic examination. Okay. Now, the initial stage of fatty liver is that there is deposition of these fat droplets around the nuclei. These are small vesicles and this is called microvesicular fatty change. As these vesicles tend to accumulate, the vesicles become larger in size, and once these become larger in size, they tend to push the nucleus to the periphery, and this stage is called macrovesicular fatty change. That one was microvesicular fatty change, and this one is macrovesicular fatty change. And now, imagine the same thing happening in all the hepatocytes. So what happens here is that these macrovesicles, they can fuse together, okay, and then they can form fatty cysts. These are the fatty cysts which are formed as a result of fusion of many of these macrovesicles. Sometimes, you know, these fatty cysts can also rupture and then can elicit an intense granulomatous response in the form of accumulation of lymphocytes. Few macrophages can also come in, and then multinucleated germ cells. So essentially, these are the microscopic features of fatty liver. One, the presence of microvesicles in the initial stage, then you have macrovesicular change, and then fatty cysts, and finally you can expect some amount of granulomatous response. So how does this look in a real histopathological examination? So this is a section of fatty liver where you can easily see that it's all empty looking spaces, isn't it? As I told you, the fat looks yellowish only in gross examination, whereas in microscopy, because of the processing, it is appearing clear. Okay, we will know more about how to identify whether this clear space is fat or not. Okay, as of now, we just see that these are of various sizes. These smaller ones are microvesicles and the larger ones are macrovesicles. The same thing, this could be a fatty cyst here. Now, we will talk about how fat can be demonstrated whenever you have, whenever you see a cell with empty looking space. Okay, see, this empty looking space can be of three things. One, it could be a fat, it could be a glycogen, or it could be just plain water. Okay, so how do you demonstrate fat? Fat can be demonstrated in fresh, unfixed tissue by a process called frozen section. Okay, because we know that during routine processing in histopathology, the fat gets dissolved. So that is the reason why we have to demonstrate the fat in fresh and unfixed tissue. Okay, so what are the special stains for fat and what is the color which is taken by the fat? The first one is Sudan 3, the fat takes yellow color. Sudan 4, the fat takes orange color, red in oil red O, black in osmic acid and Sudan black B. This is a oil red O stain done on a unfixed frozen section slides. Okay, all those empty looking vacuoles now is stained with oil red O and that is an intense red color stain. This is what a special stain can do. Okay, you can easily demonstrate fat. Okay, now consider at this point, if you see that this particular liver tissue has not taken this oil red O, that means to say that this could not be fat. So the left out is two things. One, it could be glycogen or it could be water. Now what do you do? Okay, the fat is ruled out. You're left out with glycogen and water. So you take a PAS stain and stain it. Okay, so the periodic acid skiff reagent stains glycogen. If there is glycogen, then that particular vacuole will be stained pink in color. If PAS doesn't stain and oil red O doesn't stain, that means it is no fat, it is no glycogen. So it has to be just a hydropic change. That's all. All this while we were discussing about the fatty change in the liver. Now we need to know that fatty change can also occur in other organs, particularly in the heart. So there is an alteration of yellowish streaks and reddish streaks in the heart. The yellowish streaks are the ones which has this characteristic fatty change. The reddish streaks are the ones which are normal or unaffected myocardium. So the combination of yellowish and reddish streaks results in something called as tigroid or tabby cat appearance. Okay, so the tabby cat appearance, the name is because of this particular cat. This is a tabby cat where you can see alternate dark and light bands. Okay, so the dark band is the reddish streak in the myocardium, whereas the light band is yellowish streak in the myocardium. The yellowish means fatty change, the reddish means normal or unaffected myocardium. So remember, fatty change in heart is also referred to as tigroid or tabby cat appearance. Now, what are the effects of fatty change? As I told you earlier, fatty change, there can be no effects if it is mild. But if it is severe, it can impair function because of irreversible cell damage. Now let's move on to other lipid accumulations. Okay, it could be cholesterol and cholesterol esters. The most common example which we give in cholesterol accumulation is atherosclerosis. We all know that atherosclerosis is the cholesterol accumulates in the smooth muscles and the macrophages in the intima of the blood vessels, particularly the arteries. In the case of hereditary hyperlipidemia, the cholesterol accumulates in the macrophages, usually under the skin, and these are the ones which form tumor-like structures, and these are known as xanthomas. So xanthomas are basically the collection of macrophages with accumulated cholesterol. Okay, they are seen in the cases of hereditary hyperlipidemias. So in conclusion, we just discussed about intracellular accumulations. We talked more about intracellular accumulation of lipids, particularly accumulation of neutral fat, that is known as fatty liver. So we also know that neutral fat is a triester of fatty acids and glycerol. It's basically a triglyceride. And we also talked about accumulation of cholesterol and cholesterol esters. So that completes today's topic. Thank you for watching. You can access PowerPoint presentations at this particular site, that is ilopathology.com. If you like this video, please hit the like button. Do comment. Don't forget to subscribe because you will be updated of the videos which I'll be uploading in the coming days. Okay, please do share. Thank you.